A very good morning to all the participants. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for conceptualizing this faculty development program. And yesterday I had a couple of meetings, but on and off I could join in the inaugural session. And I would have loved to join other sessions as well, but because of some scheduled meeting, I couldn't join. I'm assuming that's going very well. I had also glanced through the lectures that has already taken place. So you by now have a fairly good idea of mathematical modeling in the context of other unit operations. Professor Brahmadev talked about basic oxygen for mass transfer, and Professor G.G. Roy talked about iron making technologies, modeling in iron making technology. Now, continuous casting is after you have made the liquid steam, there is unit operations related to cleaning of steel, secondary steel making we call it, and there would be a separate lecture on secondary steel making, but because secondary steel making was not covered and we are talking about casting today, I will just briefly touch upon that, what are the different issues that we try to handle during secondary steel making prior to we solidify liquid steel into solid cast. And we have chosen continuous casting, although there are some significant applications where ingots are still needed, but by and large, most of the castings, 95-97% plus castings are through continuous casting. So its importance is overwhelming, and it sort of covers all the steel that we make in transforming it from liquid to solid. And then going forward, there are different types of product routes that it takes. So obviously continuous casting, as you will see during my lecture, the subject is too vast, but I hope that you will get the difficulties, the challenges, and what all you can get from mathematical modeling. An overview of all of this during this lecture. So I have largely taken materials from making, shaping and treating of steel, three chapters, mostly from chapter 4 and 5, and some part from chapter 6, one or two images from there. And then recently Brian Thomas, he has been active in modeling of casting operations for very, very long time, and single handed focus is on continuous casting. So he has reviewed, this review article is in second, and third is a very small issue that we are discussing, that how choosing a correct physics is important rather than a comprehensive physics. So there are not too many references, but if you are interested, lot of back references that are there referred at the back of the chapters, as well as the couple of papers that I have cited, that will be helpful if you are interested in knowing the subject in more detail. So first question is that why model? And obviously from industrial perspective, the modeling is for variety of reasons. It could be to improve your productivity, meaning thereby that you have some set points of casting speed, you have some set points of water flow rate through your mold and so on. And you would like to know that for a particular grade, am I doing the best that I can do at plant level, or can I go more? So that's related to productivity. All plants would like to maximize their productivity. Second is that as we go for newer steel quality requirements are becoming more and more stringent in the same plant. Like, I mean, if you are from plant, you would readily recall that the quality specifications that you had 10 years back and what you have now, it has changed significantly, both in terms of the tolerance that you can give in alloy composition and also the impurity level in terms of, like, I mean, oxygen level or in terms of nitrogen level and so on and so forth, sulfur, phosphorus, all of them are coming down. So sometimes it may require you to do design modification, and model is a tool to do design modification. Then we keep coming with newer grades, and the newer grades require, if you do plant level trial, it may be a very costly operation. So sometimes model can be used as a, I mean, of course, I must emphasize it again and again. I'll come to that point, that when I talk about model, I always mean that model is very well validated. Otherwise, I don't consider it a model. So model is representative of the system only when it reflects the system. Okay. Then models in some sense can also be used for online, offline supervisory control. I mean, model-based controls are becoming more and more popular. Of course, like, I mean, one of the aim for model is to improve the quality, and I will come, I have a separate slide on what we mean quality in context of continuous casting. And then also model can help in plant logistics because often in plant we have sequence casting, we have too many casters, we have too many secondary steel making on unit operations, and if you are on the shop floor, you know that everything is dynamic. I mean, in a particular place, ladle got stuck up for 5 minutes and caster has to respond, or some other caster is waiting for heat and you have to do a little bit of more arcing in ladle and so on and so forth. So I think that's a pretty dynamic situation. And again, if you leave everything to experimental data, then it will be sort of like, I mean, delaying the operations and therefore the productivity loss. So model can be and have been helpful in helping in plant logistics. We next go to, like, I mean, what to model. Like, this is very important. And in the next slide that I will show you, that the complex physics that we have in continuous casting, or for that matter, any industrial process. Just because I'm talking about continuous casting today, it doesn't mean that continuous casting is complex and others are simple. No, all processes at industrial scale are very, very complex. And you will see that depending on what you need, you will have to narrow down your focus actually. So whether you are doing heat transfer and solidification modeling, whether your focus is on fluid flow, whether your focus is on thermomechanical, sorry for the typo there in mechanical, segregation or microstructure or macrostructure, depending on what your requirements are, you will be choosing a subset of the physics and you will be trying to address. And in doing so, you have to be very, very careful that, have I missed out whatever I am taking, say, as simplifying assumption, have I missed out the crucial ones? That's very important. You should not miss out the crucial physics that you are trying to address or you're trying to get when you are trying to model this. So that's very important. And before coming to mathematical model, it's not the only type of model that we should be thinking of. There are other type of models that we use to know. In fact, you can consider lab experiments also as a model. They also are trying to highlight, for example, if you are trying to get heat transfer coefficient in a mold through experiments that you are trying to design in a way that it is helpful to get you information for your model at plant level, that itself is a model. Physical model, by now you are all very much familiar that, like, for example, the steel is a high temperature material and opaque, and we gain a lot of insight by using cool model of the system. Water is a very good representative model material because of its closeness of dynamic viscosity. So at least fluid flow related phenomena, we use water model very, very comprehensively first to understand phenomena, also to generate data which can be used for validation of the model itself, mathematical model itself. Then we have pilot scales, and pilot scales are between lab scale and plant scale, and pilot scales are themselves a model, actually, model of the actual process that we have. So there are very many type of models that we use, and all of these are not compartmentalized. Actually, all of them help each other. Our goal is that how to reduce the trials, etc., at plant level with the help of all these models, so that our cost of changes that we want to make, whether it is in terms of quality, whether it is in terms of productivity, and so on, or design, those are reduced significantly. So next we come to mathematical model. And as I told you in the beginning, now I will come when I describe continuous casting system, then you will get more clarity on this, that what do I mean by simplifying assumption. So you will be having a very complex system. You will be saying that, okay, I am taking a steady state. I am taking two dimensional. I am taking only heat transfer based model, no fluid flow, etc., etc. When you are trying to address a particular phenomena in the entire gamut of things, and that's called simplifying assumptions. And once you have that boundary created, then you will have governing equations that will be now applicable. Then often you require numerical solutions for those. You may require data, as I told you, from literature, but then again, literature data are created by laboratory experiments, plant experiments, pilot scale, etc. So all those data for model tuning and validation. And this is a very, very important step. I keep emphasizing that because of the availability of modeling tools now, I often tend to think that whatever comes from the model is correct. That's not true. Model tuning and validation is very, very important. And then you apply mathematical model for various different things that you are concerned with for your particular application. And I was talking about cast product. So typically, if you have interaction with plant people, they will be more worried in terms of quality issues that they face actually, and it may be surface and internal cracks, hot sharpness, oscillation mark, hook formation, reoxidation, cleanliness, shape defects. There are number of surface defects actually, and internal defects like segregation and cracks. Caster breakout is a common phenomena and very, very time taking to heal. Entire plants come to a standstill, surfacing. So now what happens is that all these quality issues are faced by plant people day in, day out, and how some of these, not all of these, some of these can be addressed through mathematical modeling. That's the main challenge. And as we are going forward, more and more defects, complex defects, are amenable for modeling and simulation, and therefore we are harnessing the benefit of those tools. We now come to the schematic of simplified view of caster, continuous caster operation. It's more akin to a slab caster, you can say. This is a very simplified view. You have three different vessels, ladle, tundish, and caster, okay, shown schematically. Now, there will be a separate lecture on mathematical modeling of ladle operations, ladle refining, ladle furnace, or degassing, etc. Similarly, tundish can be a separate topic in itself, and caster we are discussing today. What I wanted you to take a look at this is that these three equipment that you are seeing at the place where they are in the caster, when lateral is supplying liquid steel to tundish. Okay, so just to give you an overview, this ladle, which is now supplying to tundish, would have been in one of the secondary steel making operations, whether it is ladle furnace or whether it is RH degasser, etc., etc. Some plants may still be following direct sending out of ladle from primary steel making by making additions and purging, but very few. I think that most of the quality requirements that we have, we focus more and more on secondary steel making, and that is carried out in, as I told you, many, many vessels, but primarily ladle furnace and then some of the degassing operations that one could have in addition to ladle furnace. So after you have treated your primary steel, recall your yesterday's lecture of Professor Brahmadev, primary steel that you made, this steel is treated in secondary steel making unit operations. And for the sake of simplification, I call it ladle furnace. Let's say ladle furnace, where you are primarily carrying out deoxidation and you are equipped with arcing there. Okay. So about an hour you took to convert your primary steel into secondary steel. Primary steel, you recall, will have less phosphorus, less carbon, almost no alloying elements. In ladle furnace, you will do all the alloying elements that you require, but more importantly, you would also want to get rid of oxygen that has come to about 600 ppm in primary steel making. You'll get rid of that during ladle furnace. This ladle furnace output, you are bringing that ladle to the caster, and this is opened when another ladle which was supplying to tundish gets over. So this ladle that you are seeing here right now is the ladle which was waiting earlier at the turret. And the moment that particular heat is over, this ladle is now supplying to tundish, and tundish is supplying continuously to caster. And whatever this gray area that you are seeing in the caster is the liquid metal of that cast section. I'll come to that in a little bit more detail to make you understand. So we are continuously getting supply of liquid from ladle to tundish and from tundish to caster. So in a way, these three operations are interlinked. In fact, those of you who are having some experience at the caster side, you would know that casting a speed during the course of a heat, during the course of ladle supply, changes significantly actually. Okay, because tundish outlet temperature keeps changing. So depending on tundish temperature, the casting speed is adjusted. And these are in control loop actually. So the moment casting speed is changed, the opening of tundish is changed, and the opening of ladle is changed. These are in close control loop actually. Okay. So these three things should be thought together when we are talking about quality. And many times we do simulations to understand our phenomena better by taking simplifying assumptions of a steady state. But we must not forget that all these processes are highly dynamic actually. Okay. And that's the point I wanted to make, because ladle, while it is supplying heat, is always unsteady process because it's losing its weight all the time. Also, it's losing its heat all the time. Tundish is being maintained, but because tundish input in terms of temperature is changing, this is also a transient input. And caster, for the same reason, because tundish output is changing with time, therefore caster response is also dynamic. And so it is whatever pseudo steady state that we consider, that's an assumption. Okay. In addition, those who are familiar with caster operation, you would know that there is oscillation of mold all the time for preventing the stuck up of strand with the mold. And this itself is a dynamic. Okay. we have a very, very dynamic operations, and these three operations, rather, at this point, when it is waiting at turret, supplying to Tundish, Tundish supplying to caster, these three should, in a way, thought as a one unit, actually, when it comes to deciding the quality of caster. And you can see that Tundish, which was shown as a very, very simplified vessel here, and Ladal is very, very simplified entity shown here. There can be many things. In fact, Tundish, you will have dams and weirs and impact pad and so on, actually. So this is a complex unit operations to facilitate intrusion removal to the extent possible during the passage of liquid from Tundish exit, the entry point to the Tundish exit, actually. So this is an important thing that we should consider, that all these unit operations that are shown simplistically are not so simple. Next, we focus a little bit more on the caster side, actually, and these are all taken from the reference that I have put on the in the bracket, actually. So now you can see, and we are right now only focusing on the mold region, actually. So this is copper mold that is shown here, actually. You are seeing this, the meniscus here. This is liquid mold flux. Solid mold powder is here. Then you have, and we have a detailed view of this, actually. So this copper mold, between copper mold and this liquid, then there is a solidified regime, and also there is a thin regime of mold powder. That detailed view we will be seeing sometime later. The nozzle that connects Tundish to caster is known as submerged entry nozzle, and there are again a lot of design related issues here. You can see this port height, port angle, number of ports. Okay. The submergence depth, all of these are important, actually. So there are, again, modeling of submerged entry nozzle, design of submerged entry nozzle. This is a very important topic, actually. Okay. And liquid steel coming in here, how the nozzle clogging, etc., that take place here, all these are very, very important from the point of view of quality of the cast product, actually. Okay. So this is a more detailed view of Tundish and caster with respect to the entry of liquid. Okay. And we are having a more expanded view now of the regime which is at the interface of metal strand and copper mold, actually. So this is expanded now. Now you can see that we have liquid flux shown as white material here. Then we have this red regime, which is solidified steel shell. And this solidified steel shell, what we call a strand, support rest of the liquid, actually, when it comes out of the mold. And whatever you are seeing here, actually, this irregular, uneven thing, actually. So there are quite a few things that you will observe on the surface of this. You see this small notch here. These are oscillation marks, actually. Okay. Then you have resolidified flux here. And there is also air gap that forms, actually. So copper mold, it may be about a meter copper mold. It may have direct contact with the liquid flux at some place, but in some other places, it may have contact with the steel only through the solid flux powder. And further lower, there may be air gap, and then there will be solidified layer and so on. And the unevenness here that you are seeing, because this solid strand that you have here, these are at high temperature. Thickness is also small. High temperature means that the strength is not very high. and it has lot of liquid steel inside this actually, and now that you don't have any support, it is subjected to ferrostatic pressure on one side and support roll at other side. So you see this bulging of the shell that is happening, and some of the defects, significant defects, arise because of this bulging actually. Okay, so now you see that once you are expanding the view, you see that how caster is like, I mean, in terms of different physics that is now coming up. Now go and have a focus here actually. You will have the fluid flow. This is like, I mean, high speed turbulent flow is coming. The metal jet is coming out of this nozzle port actually, submerged entry nozzle port. And argon bubbles, because of its buoyancy, tries to go up. Now, one of the design issue that you want to consider here is that because it will try to go up, you would not like this argon bubbles to go and meet this solidifying front here. Because if it meets this solidifying front and if this bubbles get entrapped at the solidifying front, then you have a hole inside a caster, which will be disaster for you. Okay, so design, when we take all these into account, we have to consider that the flow should be such that argon bubbles in its path never meets the solidifying front. Also, the liquid flux, which is a kind of like, I mean, slag material in some way, it should not come and become part of this whole thing and end up in the solidified part of the caster. So there are many, many important issues that fluid flow related important issues that we want to understand here. There is a solid, then there is another phase, liquid phase, and then there is a third phase, and then I have argon gas, and then I have solid particle. So multiple entities are there, as you can expect, and this is what makes the physics so complex. Even from the heat transfer point of view, what you thought was a very simple thing. I have a copper mold. I'm cooling the copper mold with the help of water. I'm extracting heat from there. So what is big deal about it? And then I'll show you that the big deal is that there are so many different layers, which is not uniform right from the top to the bottom. And not only that, depending on what grade we are talking about, all these dynamics will change. The shell thickness, the thickness of the liquid layer, the thickness of the solidified layer, the gap, etc. All of this will change. So that's what makes it complex actually. And if this changes, then heat transfer, the heat that you are extracting is changing. So everything else will change then. And what is your metallurgical length? How much shell thickness is at the exit? All of this will change. And that is what makes it so interesting and challenging actually. Okay. Further, more detailed view on this mold flux part of it. And we have already discussed it. So there is a liquid flux layer, then there is a solid flux layer. You can see oscillation mark in more detailed form. The solid part can have, again, like, I mean, more layers, like, I mean, can have the granular part, then it can have crystalline layer, and it will have liquid flux layer, glassy flux layer. So that is depending on what temperature regime it is, there are different, like, I mean, layers that will be having, because the material that we have in this, I mean, the composition, we will see that this is a combination of large number of oxides, etc., that form our mold flux. And the temperature range at which it becomes liquid, then it becomes solid. So because mold side, you are typically talking about temperature range of around, say, 70 to 130, 140. So therefore, there is a temperature gradient from this side to all the way to this fan surface. And there are different layers of flux material. This is an exaggerated figure. It doesn't, it's not like, I mean, so huge in terms of, like, I mean, total thickness actually. But to just provide you more clarity, it's an exaggerated. Okay. So now, let us first talk about one simple objective that we want to model the shell thickness of the strand as it comes out of the caster at the mold exit. Why is it important? It is important because if your cell thickness is too small, or if it is exiting at a higher temperature, then it is too weak. It may lead to caster breakout, and our plant will come to standstill. All of us who are associated with casting operations would like to avoid caster breakout at any cost. And we have so many different gadgets that we place, online sensors we put to get an early warning system that our operation is not leading to a breakout situation. And whenever such things happen, we take some remedial measures to avoid that if we can. But in order to model this, actually, you will require a very good idea about what is the mold flux value or what is heat transfer coefficient between the water that is carrying heat away from the entire mold. So that's the part that we are talking about. And now you can see that before we go and model heat transfer and solidified thickness, solidification physics, we have to estimate that what is the flux, what is the heat flux at different different height in the mold actually. Okay, and now it is all like, and this is your strand regime, this is your liquid flux, this is your solid flux, this is your casting flux layer, and then this is gap, and this is your mold actually. And you have like, I mean, you can say that this strand temperature is T, after this liquid this strand is at TO, and your mold is maintained at TM. So this, like, I mean, the distance between these two is DCF actually, and lambda apparent is your you can say conductivity related parameter, which is a combination of all of this actually. So effective conductivity, in a way, representing lambda is representing effective conductivity. So our task is to get a correlation, a valid correlation of Q, which we can then use in our modeling and get the solidified shell thickness at the exit of mold. So there are, and as you can now expect, that lot of experimental work has been carried out at laboratory scale using the mold flux powder. This is some image that I have taken from the reference that I mentioned. You look at the bottom actually, what, so these two, this is for two flux actually. Flux one has 32% silica, 32% calcium oxide, 77.5% alumina, 4.5% Na2O, 1.1% Fe, 4.5% F, 0.6% MgO, etc., etc. And the flux 2 has 3.5% FeO, all other composition remaining same actually. So the different main difference is that flux 2 has additional 3.5% FeO in it actually. So that itself leads to a lot of changes in characteristics actually, that's one. And second is that the heat flux values actually, it keeps changing, okay, with different thickness that you are having. So there are different thickness for with which you have taken this measurement, and these are the basis on which you estimate that what will be the flux value. This is a laboratory experiment, laboratory data that you perform these experiments in lab and try to get this correlation. So different surface temperature here maintained, and then what is the heat flux that you are getting actually. So this is how you generate data using different. So now mold flux, if you are changing, first you go back to the lab experiment, characterize your heat flux data, and then try to plug this data and estimate then for the alloy that you want to cast now and get the shell thickness for your casting operation. Okay. And this is the apparent layer thermal conductivity as a function of a strand temperature from the same source for two different fluxes. Important thing that you should be noting here is that flux composition, you saw that all things same, only for 3.5% FeO changing, there's a drastic change in behavior of apparent thermal conductivity and the heat flux that comes out of it. So, and we do not have much of theoretical knowledge on flux material, mole flux material, and therefore we depend a lot on laboratory experiment to characterize this. So when we are talking about modeling, right from the beginning, I'm trying to put forth that this is in conjunction with experimental data. If you don't have a good view of what is heat flux that is out of this mold actually, and which is dependent on mold flux material and surface temperature and so on and so forth, then you are not going to have a good prediction of your shell thickness. And it is better to have no prediction than to have a wrong prediction. Because as a modeler, if you are going to use model in plant, be very careful, because once you make model predictions based on which you are giving some recommendations, and it is not from a validated model, or if it's wrong, actually, implications are huge, actually. So therefore, if you are attempting to use that model, and you can use it very successfully, caution is that never try to have a shortcut approach, actually. Have enough data for validation, tuning of the model, and see the predictive power before you go and apply it in the plant. Now, the rest of the things in slide, you can see that what these different heat flux components are made up of, and how you can have simplified relations for different flux. Like, for example, average flux inside the mold, this relationship you can apply to get a view of what will be the shell thickness that will be coming out. So this is because you have now some confidence on what is the actual data that you have. You have averaged it out. Now you can say that I will be predicting my shell thickness at the exit of the mold with a lot of confidence. Going further, actually, because all the defects that we talk about in continuous casting, they don't get generated in the mold region, although significant defects get generated in mold region, but there are very important defects, and especially I would like to draw your attention to segregation and bulging. These defects are related. Bulging is the main cause of segregation in slab caster. And this bulging happens once the strand has come out of the mold, actually. Okay, so secondary cooling, modeling of secondary cooling becomes equally important. So the next few slides, you will see that the nozzles which are spraying and how the heat flux, so between the rolls, you have nozzles which are spraying on the water is sprayed on the strand, and how the heat flux distribution measurements have been made with the replica system generated at the lab scale, and characterization of nozzle in terms of heat flux has been done, and those data can then be used to see the progress of solidification as the strand is going down, actually. And those are important from the point of view of prediction of bulging, what is the strand temperature at different locations, what is the strength of the strand, because thermomechanical models require the temperature, and temperature dependent properties are there, actually, which are very important. So it's important to have a good temperature modeling of the strand, and that requires good estimate of heat flux that goes out of the mold surface, actually. Okay. So some average value of typical heat transfer coefficient in secondary cooling zone, because some things are coming under direct spray, certain things are under dry zone, and certain things are under roll contact. So when you are modeling this entire thing, where exactly is your strand location, and what is the heat transfer coefficient to be employed there, this gives you a rough idea, because not all the places you have the same heat transfer coefficient. So what we have talked so far is that how to get a good boundary condition, because we are trying to solve, we will be solving partial differential equation, partial differential equation for heat transfer will require boundary condition, and boundary condition will dictate what will be the temperature inside and how to get that boundary condition. Experiments play a huge role there, and that's what was I was trying to put emphasis on. Now you can see that with using some simplified correlation also, you can get apparent shell thickness at the mold exit actually, and see the variation of shell thickness with a strand velocity. Okay, so non-linear variation, and also it's very critical. So unless you have the required shell thickness, also the temperature, you will not be able to. So there are plant people have some criteria. So the exit temperature at the mold, what should be the temperature, and what should be the shell thickness, and both these things should be met actually. With simplified model, you may not be able to get that, but if you go into the detailed models that we talk later, you will be able to get both the information from the model. And this is where we are heading next actually. So now we are talking about modeling of heat transfer. This is where I want you to focus your attention on the governing equation that is shown here. I showed you when I was discussing physics that there is a lot of fluid flow related phenomena that happens in caster. But when I'm showing you here in this particular model of heat transfer, I'm almost showing you no fluid flow related thing. Okay. And this is a simplifying assumption. The reason for that is that our focus here is to model temperature. And if we ignore fluid flow and bring that effect of fluid flow through conductivity in some way, then we have simplified our model. And of course, whenever you make some simplification, you have sacrificed some accuracy. And as long as that sacrificing, whatever we have sacrificed, is not significant, it gives us a huge leverage. Because if I have accounted for fluid flow in some simplified way through enhanced conductivity in the liquid regime, then we can model a two-dimensional section, not in the axial direction, but in the transverse direction, and run through that section along the length. So what I'm trying to say here, is that if I have ignored fluid flow, I am only focusing on heat transfer and solidification, and fluid flow is accounted through some enhanced conductivity of liquid. Our focus is to get shell thickness, temperature in the strand, etc. Okay, not so much fluid related phenomena. In that case, we can take a two-dimensional section in the strand and run through this caster and predict what will be the liquid pool, what will be the metallurgical length, etc., what will be the temperature in the strand very accurately. And what we have gained through this simplification, our model will run much, much faster. Okay. And obviously, you have to validate your model. And before you have done validation, you will not be able to use this model adequately. But our experience show that as far as heat transfer is concerned and shell thickness is concerned, this simplification works well. And as is depicted in this graph here, this model gives you the temperature as a function of distance from the meniscus at different locations, center distance from the slab surface, 50 mm, 40 mm, 30 mm, all the way to surface. And when it comes to surface, then you see there is a lot of fluctuations. And these fluctuations, as you can very well understand, this is coming because roll contact has different heat transfer coefficient, direct impinging jet has different heat transfer coefficient, dry zone has different heat transfer coefficient. So at surface level, you have a lot of fluctuations that as you move inside the fluctuations die down, and as you move towards the center, you have a very, very smooth temperature from the top to the bottom. So this is one aspect of modeling. As I had told you, that you can model heat transfer, solidification. You can also, like for example, we talked about fluid flow related phenomena. How the submerged entry nozzle, when it lets the fluid enter caster, what is the flow related phenomena that happen? And if your task is that, then probably you will be better off by ignoring heat transfer altogether. And that is how people have done actually. A lot of modeling effort has gone in where you have tried to model fluid flow, but ignore heat transfer. Okay. And in the process, you can also have a cold model of this particular operation made in laboratory or in plant. And some of the cold model by pushing some tracers, colorful tracers, you can see that whether the model predictions and the cold model images, they are in good correspondence or not for validation of your model. So typical approach will be like this. I will have a mathematical model made from the equations that are shown. So this is your equation of continuity. This is your equation of momentum. Then you have turbulence. This is turbulent model. You can pick up some turbulent model. Let's say you choose K epsilon model or some model you choose for modeling turbulence. Now, you model the water-based system first, and you have corresponding experimental data from your physical model, which is your cold model that you have created in your plant or in your laboratory. And you try to validate your water model, mathematical model, with the results from physical model that you have. You can even have velocity measurements done here, and you can compare that with the model prediction coming out of the numerical solution of these equations. Now, let me tell you, some of you must be already familiar with tools like ANSYS or earlier like COMSOL and so on, which are routinely used for solving these partial differential equations. But the basic fundamentals behind this is that these equations are solved through discretization and then linearization, and we solve those linear equations in using numerical tools like finite volume methods, etc., or finite element methods. And whatever tools that we are seeing, like whether it is ANSYS or COMSOL, those tools are based on those techniques that we talk about, finite volume methods or finite element methods. And as a user, we may not bother how it has come about, but if you are going to be a detailed user of this modeling, it may be worthwhile to go through some of those courses which talks about finite volume methods or finite element methods as applicable to fluid flow and so on. And there are certain courses on NPTEL and Coursera that you can consult for. But as you are using it as a black box, you can still simulate this water model, compare it with the laboratory data, see if there is a requirement for any adjustment of parameters. And once you are satisfied there, then you know that whatever model that you have assumed here is good enough. And because of certain resemblance of water properties, dynamic properties of water and steel, then you go back to your original caster dimension that you have in plant and original material, and you simulate. And these are routinely utilized for optimization of sand design in plant actually. And then once you come up with that sand design using such techniques, you can then fabricate it and try it and have better quality in terms of entrapment or in terms of avoidance of intrusions coming in. And these are typically, why do we need it? Typically what happens is that with time, we want to maximize our productivity. And whenever you take on this, actually, you will be facing a problem, a dilemma, that our send design is not optimum to take the increased casting speed and so on. And that makes us look at things. And at plant level, if you do experimentation, it will be too costly. So you can take this route. But important takeaway from this slide is that while modeling this, I am taking fluid flow in greater detail, but I have ignored heat transfer altogether, because my focus is on fluid flow related phenomena much more than the heat transfer. And heat transfer leads to thermal gradient. Thermal gradient leads to thermal buoyancy. Thermal buoyancy can also cause flow, but that we ignore in this particular case. We simply say that thermal buoyancy related flow can be neglected in comparison to the forced flow that we have from the liquid that is entering the system. So that's the basic assumption. And as I told you, that once you make this assumption, you say that, I mean, there is a small slanting of the domain. That slanting you can do, that is slanting, you can have a model where you can have the slanting already placed. So this is the main takeaway from this slide, that depending on what is our focus, we should be concentrating there. And take out the important physics, leave out the rest, because actual process is too complex. And if you keep everything, then if there is something that goes wrong in the model, one is that model will be very slow. Second, you will end up with too many parameters. You have very limited data, and you will not be able to figure out what is causing error in your model, actually. So that's the reason or motivation behind going for simplification. And of course, if your focus is on dissipation, how heat is dissipated, then you cannot ignore heat transfer in that. And so in that case, you bring in the heat flux also, and you can, then you have to get all the things that you have in terms of liquid flux, solid flux, etc., and you can model all this together. As our computational power is increasing, as our algorithms are becoming more and more robust, we are able to take a lot more physics than we could do earlier. Okay. Then lot of defects in caster emanates from a stress that gets generated in the strand and the solidified shell or in the mold, actually. And those stresses are generated because we have thermal gradients, we have different expansion coefficients at different locations, and uneven heat distribution. All of these causes a stress generation, and these are very important from the point of view of, let's say, for example, surface crack or rhombodity or distortion of mold. All of these are at some level related to the stress overcoming the elastic regime. The plastic deformation has taken place, permanent deformation has taken place, that has given rise to the permanent distortion in the mold, or it has overcome the yield level that we have, formation of cracks, etc. And some of these may be very, very detrimental to our quality, actually. Some surface cracks can straight away lead to rejection of product, actually. Or internal crack, if it is too big, that may not heal during rolling, and that can also cause problems. And normally, if I know that, okay, there are cracks that are forming, first is that how to model this. And second is that how to reduce the stress level. Once, what is the objective of modeling? Stress in the caster, strand. The the main motivation is that we want to minimize the crack potential of crack formation actually. Okay, and what operating conditions? Sometimes higher casting speed may have to be sacrificed in order to avoid crack formation. So productivity and quality do not always go hand in hand. And if quality is the prime concern, then you may have to sacrifice productivity in certain case, but in certain other cases, stress can also be relieved by proper design modification. Okay. Also, you should be concerned with the bulging, like we talked about bulging. Bulging leads to macro segregation, and how to minimize bulging to avoid, you cannot avoid segregation, to minimize central line segregation is also a very, very important problem. Okay. And this again, there are set of problems which are purely thermomechanical, but there are set of problems which calls for both computation of fluid flow and computation of thermomechanical behavior of solid strand together to get an idea. And macro segregation is what someone said, defect. Central line segregation that comes about is through the combination of these two. We will have perhaps something more to discuss later on. So this is related to the stress computation in a strand and lower down. Okay. And as you can see that, like, and in this particular plot, you are seeing that what is the typical temperature and a stress distribution through the shell thickness actually. So there is a distribution of a stress that you have through the shell thickness. And if the strength at a particular location is not high, okay, and a stress level is very high, then that can lead to crack formation, obviously, okay. I told you that bulging can be a cause, and bulging, when we are talking about, this is again, you are normally the fluid flow that we talk about lower down is, there are other mechanisms that come in picture, because at mold level, the flow through the nozzle is dominating the flow. But lower down, shrinkage also starts to play an important role. And in this particular case, the diagram that we are in, what is being shown here, that if you ignore bulging, then you are not accounting for all the fluid flow related phenomena. So shrinkage alone cannot explain the flow driver of all flow, and therefore flow is important for segregation. So all the mechanism that causes segregation cannot be accounted if you have not properly modeled bulging. So this is a very coupled problem that I was discussing. Here you have to model fluid flow and you have to model bulging, and you have to combine these together to get a view on central line segregation. Then, and this is what central line segregation will look like. You will have a sulfur print that you take on the transverse section. And there are certain qualitative measures that high level, low level, and so on and so forth that we do and get. This is a inclusion distribution. You know, inclusions are coming mostly from the Tundish side, but some inclusions can also be intrinsic during the solidification process that gets generated. Now, we haven't focused so much on how inclusions get segregated, but what we are trying to show here, that inclusions can also be segregated in a particular location, and this may cause problems when we are doing rolling operations. See, these were not so much of problem when we were having very thick gauge to roll actually. But as we are going for thinner and thinner gauge, this becomes very important. All of so one issues which were not so important earlier are now becoming important, and you will see more and more literature on how inclusions get segregated in the strand and how to distribute these inclusions actually. What will have what will lead to more uniform distribution of inclusion. That is also very important. So depending on what is your focus, like, I mean, inclusions, for example, you can have a uniform distribution before solidification, and as solidification progresses, then you can have a distribution, and a lot of modeling related issues are there. So this is something that we are beginning to explore now more and more. This, you are all familiar with this diagram. This is what is known as columnar and aqueous zone. This is a macro structure. This is not micro structure, macro structure. If you macro etch it, you can see this pattern through naked eye. But this is very, very important from the point of view of central line segregation. And people have enough data to suggest that if you have more equiaxed fraction, then you have less central line segregation. Okay. And yet, when you try to link it in the model, you find that the linkages are not very straightforward, actually. And I will give you an example. So I have already taken about an hour. Let me take this example. This is what I was telling you, that why it is becoming, inclusions are becoming important. So earlier, this ladle is temperature and caste composition in ladle, and then some inclusions are coming here, and this inclusions is passed to the tundish, and then tundish gives this inclusion to the caster. Now with uniform distribution of inclusion here in caster, when solidification takes place, this can distribute, and that distribution, which was earlier not so important, can become important going forward, actually. So this is all to do with, because earlier we were not talking about sub 1 millimeter thickness of the strip that we roll, but as we are going for a stronger and stronger scheme, we are going for thinner gauge, and this may become important. Okay. Let me not focus here, actually. I have some slides you can take a look, actually. I just wanted to touch upon one important thing. So macroscopically, you can model columnar equiax transition using some very simplified models. Like, I mean, Hunt has proposed a model, which is a purely geometric model. You can do, you can take a cross section, you can ignore fluid flow, and you can just, with the thermal gradient, there can be sophisticated model, but with the help of this thermal gradient based criteria, you can judge that what is your columnar fraction, what is your equiax fraction, actually. And then you try to use this model to do the parametric study. So you change the superheat. Superheat is the input to this model. Initial temperature, what is the initial temperature with which it enters caster, is a, let's say, a parameter. So what we observed, that you change superheat very drastically, and you use this model, Hunt's model, you find that there is hardly any difference in columnar or equiax fraction. Whereas plant data has there is no ambiguity in plant data that your superheat is a very, very important parameter in addressing the columnar equiax fraction. And so we tried to investigate this little bit, and first approach was to make this physics comprehensive, actually. So, like, for example, you go for inclusion of fluid flow, etc., etc., and you try to do the computation, and you find that it doesn't really help you much, actually. And then you realize that the problem is not lying with the ignoring the fluid flow, but problem is somewhere you have not related the superheat with survival of grain. So that becomes the most important parameter. In fact, if you have higher superheat, then the number of nuclei that can survive in the liquid regime will get impacted. And that number of nuclei is the seed for aqueous drain growth, and therefore it impacts the columnar aqueous transition. This aspect was not looked at actually, and that's why we were not getting a good view as to how the effect of superheat can be brought out. And this is what we did with a very simplistic mechanism. We tried to formulate that survival thing, number of nuclei, as a function of superheat. And we could show here that this is the plant observation. With superheat, what is the aqueous fraction actually? Without consideration of the linking, without consideration that your nuclei is linked with superheat, you change the superheat, but you do not get the aqueous fraction. So this is what you get. And no matter what new physics you add, you will be getting more or less this kind of plot only. But with incorporation of this physics that nuclei is a function of superheat, you are almost able to replicate the plant observation. So the learning from this particular exercise was that it's not always that making the model comprehensive will help. You cannot ignore the important physics if that is crucial for your particular output, and in this particular case, columnar aqueous transition. And how columnar aqueous transition helps in segregation, that's very well understood actually. So what happens is that if you have aqueous solidification happening at some point, then you have resistance to flow all through actually, and therefore the central line segregation does not get accentuated, and that's why you want more of aqueous fraction. Unfortunately, the more aqueous fraction comes when you have lower casting speed, and that impacts your productivity. So again, there is a trade-off actually. Okay, we can go on and on and on because this is a 1 hour lecture. I do not know how fast I went, whether it was useful or not. I tried to give you a glimpse of what can be done in caster. Before I forget, actually, a lot of things we have done with when I was, especially all the plant implementation that we have done at caster, at Ladle, etc., all when I was at Tata Consultancy Services, at TCS Innovations Lab, and had collaborations with Dr. Gautam's team under Dr. Pradeep, Anand Krishnan. And we have also, we'd like to acknowledge Professor Padmanavan, Professor Mistri, Professor Janet Allen, Professor Jitesh Panchalan, Professor Surya Kalan. All of them, now we are working together on the concept of integrated computational materials engineering, which is like for example, in the context of today's talk, how do you club together models of Ladle, Tundis, and Caster to have a unified view of quality of caster actually. So that is integrated computational materials engineering for us actually. There are a couple of slides, but there are more references. If you want to get in touch, I will be more than glad to share some literature on that. With this, I have finished my part. So,